This last Wednesday night, there were a couple who came up from Brad McLean's church at Fair Hope, and they just sent us an email afterwards. I'll read you part of it. They said, Brad had told me that the Spirit was moving at Harvest, but to understand how powerful the worship is, one has to experience it. I was amazed and awed by what God, through the Holy Spirit, is doing here. After the service, as we were walking out, we couldn't even talk. We were in awe at the power that was in that place. I want to bring some friends there if Brad preaches on another Wednesday night. They need to experience what actual revival is through the Holy Spirit. He says, thanks for your kindness. The friendly atmosphere of all there making us feel welcomed was amazing. You're all doing things right. It was such an honor to be a part of something so special. Hearing Brad share through what the Holy Spirit had for him to share was amazing. I do encourage you to take advantage, and this is just a really good time, I think, to be asking God for breakthroughs in your walk with Him, asking Him to really move in your life. There are certain times where the presence of God is being revealed more clearly than at others. We talk, I think we kind of got from the Korean church, this idea of an open heaven. And sometimes, in some places, it seems like the obstacles are just out of the way. And we can see very clearly, and God can move in us very clearly. And I think this is one of those times. So take advantage of it. Now's the time to be talking to God and just saying, Lord, touch me, move in me, show me what you want to do in me next. Do those things that I can't do for myself by your power. Just take advantage of the opportunity for him to move in you. And I think, like Keith says, great time to invite other people to come. Because I think in that atmosphere where he's revealing his presence, so easy and so clear to see the power of God and his move in our lives. Let me see if I brought everything I thought I was bringing. Yeah, okay. I want to read a couple of scripture passages to you. First is out of Habakkuk. I know your favorite book and mine. Habakkuk chapter 3, verse 17 says this, so the fig tree does not bud, and there are no grapes on the vines. Though the olive crop fails, and the fields produce no fruit, though there are no sheep in the pen, and no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God my Savior. Philippians chapter 4 says this, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you've learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you were concerned, but had no opportunity to show it. Not saying this because I'm in need, for I've learned to be content whatever the circumstances. What a great thing to learn. I know what it is to be in need. I know what it is to have plenty. I've learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do all this through him who gives me strength. And then finally, out of Psalms 1, oh, the joys of those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or stand around with sinners, or join in with mockers, but they delight in the law of the Lord, meditating on it day and night. They are like trees planted by the riverbank, bearing fruit each season. Their leaves never wither, and they prosper in all they do. Three letters that didn't come to Harvest because I don't want to, but could have used letters that came to Harvest. The first one was a letter from a woman who said that she was very unhappy, that her husband basically pursued his own interests and had never had much time for their family. And now their children were grown. She had a boyfriend in high school And they considered marriage, but she said he wasn't ready. And now the children are grown. By coincidence, they had connected with each other again. She said that she felt like it was God who had brought that connection together. And she said, you know, I know what you're going to tell me. You're going to tell me that this relationship is not right. But I know that God wants me to be happy. And this makes me happy. So if this relationship makes me happy, how can it be wrong? Another letter from a college student who says, I grew up in your church, and when I went off to college, I was determined to live as a strong Christian. But to be honest, it's been extremely difficult. While it seems like everybody around me is having fun, I feel like I've just been trying to survive. Finally, he said, I confronted a friend who's a Christian about all of his partying. And he said, what I'm doing is not hurting anybody. After all, God wants me to be happy. And that made a lot of sense to me. If God wants me to be happy, then how can living life like that be wrong? And the third letter from a couple, a woman in the couple, who said, we've been coming to your church for over a year. Recently, one of the pastors came up to me and said that he was so glad that we were coming, and then asked me to listen to a tape of one of your sermons that talked about why couples shouldn't live together before they were married. I can't tell you how offended I was at that. And then she went on to tell reasons why they needed to be living together and ended the letter with, I know that God wants me to be happy, and this relationship makes me happy. Now, as I said, none of those came to Harvest. I could have used letters that have come to Harvest. But how does God feel about that? I mean, doesn't God want us to be happy? And if he wants us to be happy, then how can the things that make us happy be wrong? I mean, that really is a major issue for many, many people, a major issue for the church. In 2 Corinthians chapter 2, Paul says, anyone you forgive, I also forgive. And what I have forgiven, if there was anything to forgive, I forgive it in the sight of Christ for your sake, in order that Satan might not outwit us, for we are not unaware of his schemes. I want to talk about this today so that we won't be unaware of his schemes. You know, we need to know how our enemy works. We need to know the lies that he tries to convince us of so that we don't fall to him, so that we don't fall to deception. You know, John 10:10, I quote often, Jesus said, I'm come that you might have life and have it to the full, or have it in all its abundance. But the rest of that verse, the first part of that verse says, the enemy comes to kill, steal, and destroy. But I have come that you might have life and have it in all of its fullness. You know, we have a real enemy who wants to destroy our lives. And the main way he does that is by deception. Because if he gets us to believe lies, if we believe them, we live like they're reality. You know, a few weeks ago, I mentioned some of those things that have been really common myths, like eating carrots will improve your eyesight, right? Well, carrots are good for you, I'm sure, but they don't improve your eyesight. As I mentioned that Sunday, that was came out of a myth out of World War II, where the Royal Air Force had installed radar on their planes, and they didn't want the Nazis to know for as long as possible. So they propagated this idea that their pilots had been on a long-term heavy diet in carrots, and so their eyesight had become exceptionally good. That was picked up by a writer for Warner Brothers who wrote it into the Bugs Bunny cartoons. And so a whole generation of people believe that carrots give you good eyesight. Well, we live like it's true, even though it's not. I also mentioned that whole thing of not swimming for however long after you eat lunch or after you eat, right? I mean, most of us grew up that way because supposedly you're more likely to cramp right after you've eaten. That's not true at all. though most of you will still make your children wait for however long after they eat lunch to go swimming, even though it's not true. If we believe it, we live like it's true. And if we believe the lies of the enemy, we live like what he tells us is true. And his goal is to kill, to steal, and destroy. In the truth, we can know life and life in all of its fullness. The logic goes like this: God wants me to be happy. If he wants me to be happy, then what makes me happy must be right. And what causes suffering and difficulty must not be God's will. And so if I believe those things, I'm going to end up worshiping false gods. I'm going to end up living for the ones that tell me that they'll bring me happiness and tell me that I won't experience any difficulty. Now, here's the irony. The irony is this: when we live by this lie, we experience less happiness in life. And we lose the goal that we're after. And we see people swallow this lie all through Scripture. You know, Eve believed she would be happier if she ate the fruit. Cain believed he would be happier if he got rid of Abel. Joseph's brothers believed they would be happier if they got rid of Joseph and sold him into slavery. Esau thought he would be happier if he ate the soup. Noah thought he would be happier if he got drunk. David thought he would be happier if he slept with another man's wife. Amnon thought he'd be happier if he had sex with Tamar. Samson thought he would be happier if he married a Philistine woman. After 999 wives, Solomon thought he would be happier if he had one more. The rich ruler thought he'd be happier if he's kept his wealth. Judas thought he'd be happier with 30 pieces of silver. Ananias and Sapphira thought they'd be happier if they convinced everybody they were generous. Jason thought he'd be happier with pornography, and Sarah, if she got in debt for a new dining room suit, and Bill, that he would be happier by embezzling money, and Sarah, Crystal, that she would be happier if she slept with him to make him love her, and Tony, that in drinking, well, he would be less unhappy. And on it goes. Happiness is the goal. And we start living like we deserve to be happy. And then we experience the pleasure paradox, which even secular studies confirm that the quickest way to be unhappy is to make our life all about our own happiness. That when that's the goal of life, we experience increasing unhappiness. We become self-consumed, and we lose joy. When happiness is the goal, it becomes more and more elusive. You know, it's interesting how Satan works and how he worked in the garden. He created this need, didn't he? This need to eat the fruit. You know, if you eat the fruit, you won't die, but you're going to be like God, knowing good and evil. Appealed to ambition and pride and selfishness. You know, in James chapter 3, James writes, "Where you have envy and selfish ambition, you find disorder and every evil practice." Some of you I know have heard before, I think it was Dallas Willard who first wrote about an incident that really took place, I believe it was in California, at a dog track. You know, whether you've ever actually been to a dog race or not, you've seen them on television. You know, they chase this little rabbit, right, that's on a rail. And I believe it was in California where something went wrong with the rabbit and it stopped. And so the dogs all caught up to it. And when they caught up to it, they didn't know what to do. You know, they just kind of wandered around and started whimpering and whining, and I mean, they were in total confusion. That's the way it is with a lot of people who are chasing the next thing to make them happy, you know? Life becomes this series of pursuits. And, you know, when I get one, I feel good about it for a little while, but whatever we chase, we know those things, those circumstances, those possessions, those accomplishments, those pleasures, they never make us permanently happy, so we have to chase something else. Because external things can't bring lasting happiness. Now, you know, happiness is a good thing. I think God does want us to be happy, but there's other things He wants more. You know, we like to see our children succeed as parents, but if they act like idiots when they succeed, it doesn't make us happy. I mean, if they're selfish, if they're mean, if they're arrogant, we've got a bigger problem than their success. Some things are more important than them feeling good and being happy. And it's the same thing with us. Some things are more important. In 1 Peter, we read, 1 Peter chapter 1, Peter writes, "Therefore, with minds that are alert and fully sober," even that language kind of gives you the idea of a task at hand, doesn't it? Because here's the reality, we have a task at hand. We're in a battle. And people know when they're in a battle that you set some things aside for the sake of something that's more important. "With minds that are alert and fully sober, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at His coming. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance, but just as He who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it's written, 'Be holy because I'm holy.' Since you call on a Father who judges each person's work impartially, live out your time as foreigners here in reverent fear. For you know that it was not with perishable things, such as silver or gold, that you were redeemed from the empty way of life." You know, catching the rabbit. "The empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect." You know, there are certain things that are more important. Be holy, he says. Certain things that are more important. Like the greatest commandment, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Like His word that says, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. Like living with Jesus as Lord of our lives. Like letting Him transform us from glory to glory. To make us godly, to make us righteous. Like building His kingdom. Like the spiritual battle we're fighting right now. The reality is this, we are created for God, we are created for the eternal, and the only way we find lasting joy is in the eternal. And that's what He wants us to realize and what He wants us to pursue. Because the world sees things differently, and we either buy into the one mindset or we buy into what God has to say to us. See, the world says, pursue pleasure first. And I guess in the Bible, the person who did that with more resources than anybody else was Solomon, who was the wealthiest man in the world in his day. And he talked about pursuing. You read through Ecclesiastes where he's looking for the meaning of life. And giving all of his wealth, all of his resources to satisfy every desire of his heart. And you know how he sums up that phase of his life? He says, it's chasing after wind. It's empty. You know, you come up trying to grasp the wind, there's nothing there. Just emptiness. But when we do that, when life all revolves around pleasure, we fall into this if-only trap. You know, if only I can get the next thing. You know, constantly chasing the rabbit. If only. If only I can have the next experience. If only I can have the next pleasure. If only I can find the next relationship. If only. A few years ago, USA Today did a survey of 52,000 people, pretty extensive survey, asked them this question, what would it take to make you happy? And here were the results. Number one, the most common result was friends and a good social life. Number two was a good job. Number three was being in love. Number four was recognition or success. Number five was sex. Number six was personal growth. Number seven was a good financial situation. Eight, having a house. Nine, being attractive or beautiful. 10, health or good physical condition. 11, living in the right place. 12, religion. 13, recreation and exercise, 14 children, 15 marriage. And a lot of those things are good, but most all of them are external, aren't they? I mean, it's that same old thing of trying to manipulate my circumstances, thinking that what's out there will make me happy in here. What's out there doesn't have the power to make me happy in here. You know, a lot of people have this idea that if they do enough right things, then God ought to do certain things for them. You know? I mean, if I go to church, if I tithe, then I ought to get accepted to the college I want to get accepted to. I ought to make the grades. I ought to get the degree. I ought to get the job. I ought to get the girl. I ought to get the house. I ought to get the car. You know, it's kind of like a slot machine mentality. If I put the right thing in, I'll get the right thing out. And a lot of people approach religion like that. A lot of people approach Christianity like that. And of course, God isn't here to serve us. And so I think a lot of times those are the people I hear that say, you know, I tried Christianity and it didn't work for me. You know, it's this whole mentality. And a lot of times it's, you see people who grew up in church and at some point they feel like they were missing out. And so they bail out and kind of give themselves over to pursuing pleasure, and then life crashes. And a lot of them end up, you know, back in church. And a lot of times that's kind of when the light goes on and, you know, we realize that we don't really hold the key to meaning and purpose and fullness of life in ourselves. And so we really start getting serious about what God wants to do in us. It's a great thing when we come back and really find Him. It's a great thing when we don't even have to go through those things and crash. But a lot of times that's kind of what we think. You know, if really it's all about pleasure first, then there's no good role for sacrifice or for suffering. I think one of the really significant things about what Christ teaches us is this, that very significant things happen in us through suffering. You know, it was Jesus going to the cross that won our greatest victory. And the Word talks about us sharing in the sufferings of Jesus Christ. And I don't fully understand that. I don't know what everything is produced in us, but I know He's very concerned about our character, about the person He's shaping us to be for all eternity. And I always think of this one experience happened to me when I was, I think, 14 years old. I played a lot of tennis growing up, and I was on my way to play tennis with a friend. 14, we were riding our bikes, and I'd gotten in this habit of riding my 10-speed bike a lot without my hands on the handlebars. You know, it just was very comfortable with it. It was easy to guide without that. And so we were going down this street, and for whatever reason, there were not heavy traffic, but a good bit of traffic on that street. I didn't notice this little piece of a brick in the road, and so didn't have my hands. Well, I hit the brick, and so all of a sudden everything was out of control, and so knew I was about to crash. For me, my tennis racket was fairly expensive, so I carefully picked out a nice soft plot of grass to rescue my tennis racket, pitched it over there, and then I went down on the street and didn't know it till later, but I hit my head on the back of the curb. Well, fortunately, there was a guy that worked at the hospital that almost hit me. And so he stopped, checked me out. I also had a little hole in my hand from something in the bike I'd hit, needed stitches. So he took me to the hospital, and he had noticed, he saw me hit the curb. So he said, they need to x-ray you. And while I was waiting to be x-rayed, my head just started throbbing. And then everybody started doing strange things. Everybody started talking funny, you know, saying things that didn't make sense, started sounding kind of like Donald Duck, you know, it was really weird. And then for a while, I don't remember anything else till later, found out that my brain was swelling. And so they were sending me to Birmingham to remove my part of my skull to relieve the pressure. And I remember coming to one time in the ambulance and still just feeling this really, really intense pain. And I remember my first impulse, of course, was to say, Lord, take away the pain. And then all of a sudden, I just had this thought of Jesus on the cross. And just this awareness that Jesus had suffered so much more than I was suffering. And I can't tell you why, except by the Spirit of God, but for some reason I found myself saying, you know, Lord, accomplish in me what you want to accomplish. In that moment, it was not about taking away the pain. It was about God producing in me what he wanted to produce. Now, a lot of people were praying for me. When I pulled, I went out again, then came to pulling into the ER at a hospital in Birmingham, and woke up and came completely out of it. They couldn't find anything wrong with me when they got me at Birmingham, and I know the Lord healed me. But I always think of that incident, that moment when it was like I wanted to pray that the Lord would take away the pain, and the Lord reminded me of his suffering. Something happens in us in suffering, and we know that love reaches its highest expression in sacrifice. Whenever I think of this whole lie of the world that happiness comes first, I often think about these pictures of those GIs on D-Day storming the beaches in Normandy. You know, knowing what they were about to face. I mean, these doors of those, whatever, I can't remember what they call those things, but, you know, the boats they were on that they came to the beach on, and the gates come down, and here are these fortified Nazis with machine guns, and, you know, just, I mean, so many people just being cut down before they could even get out of the boat. Why would anybody risk their life for somebody else if happiness is first? You see, happiness is good, but there are other things that are more important than happiness. And the reality is, when happiness comes first, we have a very hard time being happy. See, our world tells us that happiness is based on our circumstances rather than a relationship with God. And so we spend all our time and energy trying to manipulate our circumstances. And we might can get them right to make us happy for a little bit, but then circumstances change because that's the nature of circumstances. And so we're trying to manipulate them again, and we're constantly frustrated. We're constantly trying to change things to get our circumstances right. You know, the reality is this. If it's all about our circumstances, we will constantly be discontent because circumstances will not stay the same in this life. And of course, if circumstances could really make us happy, we'd be the happiest people in history. And yet, a Gallup poll done in 2014 said that rating happiness, the United States, people in the United States are 33rd in the world in rating nations in happiness. Those born after 1945 in the United States are 10 times more likely to experience depression than those born before 1944. 10 times more likely. Even though we have more comfort, more opportunity, more stuff, more conveniences. Some of you've heard me mention this before, but so many people think if they can just make enough money, they'll be happy. And you know, I've told you before, studies have shown that people who make an average income of $33,000 a year, they say when they're asked how much would it take to be happy, they say $50,000 a year. And those who make $50,000 a year say it would take $80,000 a year. And those who make $80,000 say it would take $125,000 a year. And those who make $125,000 say it would take $200,000 a year. And those who make $200,000 a year say it would make $350,000. It would take $350,000 a year. And those who make $350,000 a year on average say it would take $500,000 a year. And those who make $500,000 a year say on average it would take $1.2 million a year. And those who make $1.2 million a year say on average that it would take $5 million a year. It's just chasing the rabbit, isn't it? You know? And so we have to decide, are we going to be content? Are we always going to chase more? Now, you know, it's a good thing to want to to accomplish for the glory of God. It's a good thing to want to make money for the glory of God. I know many people, many of you. You know, you love making money for the glory of God. And you use that position to lift him up. And you use that money to build up the kingdom of God. That's what money is for. But when that's what we look to give us meaning in life and happiness, we're constantly frustrated. It's a moving target, right? Single people think if they were only married. Married people think if they were only single. You know? The guy who said, never knew what happiness was until I got married, and then it was too late. Chronic discontent when we're looking to our circumstances to make us happy. If I only have children, if the children only grew up and we're out of the house, you know how it works. We're not going to be like that, are we? Because we're the people of God. Well, we don't need to live such foolish lives when fulfillment is offered to us in Christ. We don't have to live our lives chasing things that can never make us content. See, we can learn like that scripture we read in Philippians 4, to be content in every situation because of who our life is based on. In this world is fueled by comparison. I mentioned a few weeks ago how, you know, comparison is nothing new. But with social media, now we can compare with everybody we know. And everybody puts their best stuff on social media, and I'm glad. I don't want to read about your misery. I like to hear the good things, don't you? And yet we can subconsciously start hearing all about, you know, thinking about all of the things other people have and what they're doing and comparing ourselves. The world says compare rather than be thankful. And comparison makes people miserable. I heard about this priest in Ireland who had a woman in his church who was a chronic complainer. And he heard from some of the other farmers that this year she had the best potato crop in the whole county. And so when she was going out of church, he said, I heard that you've just got the very best potato crop. Isn't that wonderful? And she said, well, yes, it is looking pretty good, but what am I going to do when I need bad ones to feed the pigs? You know? And that's what comparison does. I mean, there's always somebody you can compare better to. There's always a way to be miserable. You've heard before about the monk who was in a strict order of a monastery where you couldn't speak. They took a vow of silence. And, you know, once a year they could say something. So at the end of the first year, he went to the monk who was in charge, and they could say two words after each year. So the first year he said, bed hard. After another year, he said, food bad. And after the third year, he said, I quit. And the monk who was in charge, he said, well, I'm not surprised. You've done nothing since you got here but complain. You know, comparison makes us miserable. Some of you probably saw on ESPN magazine the story of Madison Halloran. The article said on Instagram her life looked ideal. She made great grades, she was popular, she was a star athlete. But then it went on to talk about her suicide and how on the outside everything looked good. But on the inside she was in despair. Now, we need to never forget that everybody struggles. Everybody goes through difficulties, and we don't need to give in to the pressure of the world to always look like everything's going great in life. It's not about comparison. See, the opposite of comparison is gratitude, where we are actually thankful for what God has given us instead of focusing on what we don't have. The world says to focus on ourselves rather than to focus on others. LA Times did an article a couple of years ago on the epidemic of depression, and it said those who are 30 and under are 3 to 5 times more likely to be depressed than their grandparents. And it listed the number one reason is this: cultural occurrences that have exalted the individual. Occurrences that have exalted the individual. In other words, this perception that it's all about me. That I need to put the focus of my life on me. I heard a pastor talking who was in Chicago, and he went to a restaurant, and because he was by himself, they seated him in the bar. And he said he realized as people were coming in that it was happy hour. He said, you know, if you want to see a whole bunch of miserable people in one place, go to happy hour. Which surprised him. He said, I thought everybody would come in joking and laughing and, you know. But everybody just was miserable. A study was done of students where once a week, one group of students engaged in something that brought them pleasure. That was their assignment. The second group, once a week, engaged in some form of serving other people. At the end of 10 weeks, the psychologists found that the second group that was serving people every week was less self-absorbed, less depressed, had a greater sense of community, less loneliness. So when the goal is to make ourselves happy, we end up depressed. When we serve other people, we end up happy. You know, Jesus said, I came not to be served, but to serve. There's something in us, the way we're made. We're not created to be self-focused. We're created to be focused on God and on other people. The lie is, my life is about my happiness and I deserve to be happy. You know what the truth is? Hope this doesn't sound too severe to some of you. What I really deserve is hell. That's the truth about me. What I deserve from the way I've lived my life, from my sin, is hell. And the Son of God laid down his life on the cross to rescue me. And when I get up remembering that, it's a pretty good day, no matter what else happens. When I know what I really deserve and what I've been given, it's a pretty good day, even in the hard times. You know, it's like if you were a billionaire and you went into a city and you had $30 in your wallet and you got out of a taxi and you gave the taxi driver $10, and then a little bit later you went into a restaurant and you looked in your wallet and you only had $10. And you know you've either overpaid the taxi driver or you've lost a $10 bill somewhere. Is that going to ruin your day if you're a billionaire? Not unless you're an idiot. You know? You can let it ruin your day if you want to. You know, the reality is when we know who we serve and what he's done for us, everything else, every difficulty by comparison is nothing. You know what God does promise his people? He promises us joy. And I do believe this. I'm convinced of this. When we follow Jesus, when we live for him, we experience a whole lot more happiness in this life than when we don't live for him. You know you're forgiven, when you're not carrying guilt and shame, even subconsciously, when you know that you're clean of sin, when you know there's a purpose for your life, when you know there's an eternity that's going to be great, when the Holy Spirit fills you so that you chronically, regularly, habitually experience love and joy and peace and patience and goodness and kindness and faithfulness and gentleness and self-control, when you experience the joy of the Lord that's your strength, when those things are happening in your life, you experience a whole lot more happiness. But see, happiness comes and goes, doesn't it? By our circumstances, by the conditions around us. But he promises his people joy. Joy that doesn't come and go. Joy that can become a part of our character. You know, Christianity is the most joyful religion in the world. Has more to say about joy than any other. The fruit of the Spirit, of his Spirit being in control of us, is joy. Jesus said when he was talking about abiding in him, I'm the vine, you're the branches. If you abide in me, you'll have much fruit. I've told you these things so that my joy might be in you. And that your joy might be full. See, God is the most joyful being in the universe. E. Stanley Jones was a famous missionary to India. He told about the conversion of a Catholic woman who really met Jesus for the first time. And she said, you know, strangely enough, I never associated God with joy. But now, she said, even though she was in a very, very difficult home situation, she says, day after day, I find myself happy as a lark. Her conditions hadn't changed. Her relationship with God had changed. You see, joy is an inward quality. It can be the normal state of our lives. The joy of the Lord is our strength. When we're experiencing the joy of the Lord, temptation doesn't look so appealing anymore. In His presence, there is joy. Joy comes when we trust in Him, when we have a confidence that He keeps all of His promises. And we have confidence that our eventual destination is victory. Joy is released as we abide in Him, as we walk in the Spirit. It enables us to persevere. It makes us a blessing to other people. The playwright Oscar Wilde once said, some people cause happiness wherever they go. Other people cause happiness whenever they go. You know, when the joy of the Lord is our strength, we bless other people around us. Russell Morris served as a missionary for 30 years, mostly in a country where it was against the law to be a Christian. He was in prison for 18 months, spent 15 months in solitary confinement. One day, soldiers surrounded his house with guns, bayonets, pistols, told him to come with them. He said, can I grab a few things first? They said, oh no, you won't be very long, and as long as we have you with us, we'll provide everything that you need. He knew when he was leaving, he had seen others taken off who never returned. And so as he left, he thought to himself, you know, I don't have anything with me. I have nothing. I can do nothing. All I have is God alone. And so he prayed. He said out of the hundreds of scripture verses he had memorized, it was Philippians 4 that came to his mind. And he said, became my key verse through those 13 months. Rejoice in the Lord always. I'll say it again, rejoice. Don't be anxious for anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God that passes understanding will rule your heart and mind in Christ Jesus. I've learned the secret of being content in every situation. That became, he said, his key verse. And he said, if there was ever a time it was humanly impossible to rejoice and not be anxious, it was then. And yet, throughout that time, I found that it was him who gave me a supply of joy and peace. He said, because when you know the outcome, you can make it through the plot changes. When you know eventually there's going to be victory, you can make it through what comes between now and then. How do we live in that kind of joy? One of the great believers, George Mueller, said, I make it my business every day before I do anything else to make myself happy in the Lord, to spend time with Him until His joy is released in me, to daily surrender my rights and receive His Spirit, to learn to love Him with all my heart, to determine I will rejoice in Him regardless of the circumstances, that He will become my delight. You know, the promise out of Psalms is, if we delight ourselves in the Lord, He will give us the desires of our heart, because our desires become His desires. It's a great passage in 1 Peter chapter 1 that talks about joy inexpressible. Though you haven't seen Him, you rejoice in Him. Though He hasn't been revealed to you yet, you receive joy inexpressible, full of glory, because you know you're receiving the goal of your faith, the salvation of your souls. We walk in the joy of the Lord as we focus on His goodness. Another study, two groups. One was supposed to keep a journal. where every day they spent time writing out things they were thankful for. The second group, every day, was supposed to write down things that annoyed them. I've known some unofficial members of the second group, haven't you? The result was this. The first group experienced more energy, enthusiasm, slept better, and were less depressed. What the Lord wants us to do is pursue first things first. To know that our life is first of all about Him. And He wants to use us to bring glory to His name and to be a blessing to the people around us. We walk together in thanksgiving. We walk in His presence. And He promises us joy. And in His presence, walking with Him, we'll experience much happiness. But the joy of the Lord remains as it becomes a part of our character. And our ultimate destination is going to be happiness. Because there is going to be a day when there's no more battle. There is going to be a day when He sets everything right. There will be a day when righteousness covers the earth as the waters cover the sea. There will be a day when He wipes every tear from our eyes. And there will be a day when we're made like Him because we see Him face to face. I want you to stand with me. Lord, we just ask that You would give us grace to walk in truth and to not believe the lies of the enemy. This altar is open. Altar team, if you would come here, they'd love to minister to you. I want to ask you this. Have you given your life to Jesus? Because apart from Him, we'll experience decreasing happiness, increasing emptiness. In Him, we find meaning in life. We find the one we were made for, our purpose, His touch to redeem us and transform us. We find life in its fullness. Have you been living in sin or in an unwise way because you thought it would make you happy? If you have, this is a good day to just let that go and say, Lord, forgive me. I want to live for first things first. Do you trust Him? Are you right with God? Are you believing Him? Have you yielded to the Holy Spirit? If you know the Lord speaking to you about any of these things, I want to ask you to lift your hand as I pray for you. I just want you to be included in the prayer. Thank you. Thank you. Thanks. Thank you. In the balcony? Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. See that? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Lord, You see every hand. You see our hearts. I thank You, Lord, that You've called us to walk in truth and You've called us to walk with You. I thank You that You're the most joyful being in the universe. And like a parent delights in seeing his children happy, you want to see us happy, but you always also want to see us holy. Lord, You want to see us living in truth and living in righteousness. And you're molding us so that we will be people who share in Your glory for all eternity. So Lord, we just ask for forgiveness where we've justified things that are foolish, or wrong or sinful for the sake of our own happiness. And we just repent of that. And we ask Your forgiveness. And I thank You the blood of Jesus blots out every sin. And we ask You to do that. Lord, for some who raise their hands, we're asking You to come into us today. As we open our lives to You, that You'd put Your Spirit in us. And You'd lead our lives now. And that You would cleanse us. Lord, we just want to say, as Your followers, we renounce darkness. We renounce the lies of the enemy. We renounce the doubt that would cause us not to trust in You. We renounce any sin in our lives. And Lord, we ask now that You would be revealing Yourself in us, that we would know Your peace, Your joy, Your guidance, Your victory, and that we would have the grace to live for the praise of Your glory this week. As we walk with You, thank You for what You've done, what You're doing in us, and what You'll do in the days to come as we walk with You. We give You all the praise and glory. Altar team, want you to be at the front. And if any of you'd like prayer, you come after we dismiss. Go in the peace of God and in his joy.